would like to begin thanking the President of the Greek staff for this invitation. I see it as a sign of friendship between our peoples and the ties that we have built in the last 25 years, and of course, because we're all also all like-minded countries. In the past, other Chilean presidents have visited Sulu, but today will be the first time that a president of Chile addresses this parliament, and it's an honor that I share it deeply. First, I want to thank and acknowledge in this house, on behalf of my country and my fellow citizens, the hospitality and solidarity that Swedish people gave Chileans persecuted for trying to make Chile a more just country. Thousands of Chileans suffered. In the words of Olof Palme, and I will quote him, the naked violence which was going to stop the efforts of Salvador Allende, end of quote. Chile will never forget the noble and humanitarian gesture of Sweden. It's in our hearts and indelibly written in our collective memory. Today I'm here to talk about the present and future challenges my country faces. I want to have a dialogue over how we are setting a more solid foundation for development with equality and justice. But looking to the future requires to consider the historical context to find the source of the forces that mobilize present action. In one history, one can find, in our history, one can find a common link to the social and political construction that Sweden has followed. As you have done for decades, in recent time we have sought broad political agreements to manage our economy well and to make commitment to our public policies in order to build institutions that provide welfare to the population in a sustainable and equitable way. And we have done so by carefully examining the path followed by Sweden, a source for learning of what can be done and what needs to be avoided. Almost half a century ago, Gunnar Myrdal identified some traits in Latin America that have marked its social and political development. In essence, he observed a notorious inequality existing between the base and the top of the social pyramid. And in some sectors, for example, education, he saw the great difficulties of education systems favoring more academic over practical approaches, or placing the emphasis on coverage rather than quality. At the same time, he observed that some countries in Latin America could travel on a path of possible reforms, among them Chile, a country with such a strong tradition of general elections, Myrdal said. Regrettably, many of these features are still present in our continent. Extreme inequality remains a wall dividing our societies. But some things have changed and they're worth mentioning. It is necessary to remember first that at the beginning of the 80s, most of Latin Americans did not choose their leaders. In fact, they live under dictatorships. However, over the last 25 years, democracy has been consolidated in Latin America and is the political reality of the continent for the first time in its history. Second, a cycle of economic growth without precedent has ended. One based on the high price of commodities, in the case of Chile copper. According to the World Bank data, in the decade between 2003 and 2012, Latin America recorded growth rates of more than 5% of the GDP above other emerging countries and G7. And thirdly, that greater wealth leads to better public policies designed in democracy enable millions of Latin Americans to lead poverty decline, at least in its more severe forms. The figures indicate that between 2005 and 2015, 70 million Latin Americans left poverty, and it is estimated that the middle class in the region accounted for more than 50% of the population. So this picture shows Latin America, which is certainly better off today than yesterday. However, these same advances have given rise to new tasks. And one of the first, as it was 50 years ago, is the enormous inequality that hides behind the good figures that I have just mentioned. Not only income inequality, although gender, territorial, and ethnic inequalities. In addition, the reduction in commodity prices has led to a declining economic dynamism, which has placed downward pressure on employment and tax revenue. Along with this, there is a crisis in citizens' trust regarding the elites, and loss of legitimacy of political institutions, either through the exhaustion of conventional ways of doing politics or due to corruption scandals which greater transparency has laid bare. One consequence of this weakening of politics is that it hinders the construction of the long-term social pacts needed to solve the situation. And Chile is also affected by this reality. We have in part to the achievements in the life of Latin America, but we also share some of the pending issues. It is true that we make a positive assessment on our experience regarding social policies, economic growth, and the consolidation of our democracy over the last quarter of the century. It has been a long effort, and we are proud of it. But it's also true that the country faces major challenges as a result of problems not addressed in these years, and also as a consequence of the social and cultural progress we have experienced. These challenges are precisely at the core of the government program that we have implemented in the last 2 years. Our goal is to build an inclusive social model, sustain and sustainable economic growth, and dynamic and participatory democracy, all pillars that will contribute to make Chile a developed country. What have we achieved to date? First and foremost, education is at the heart of our changes. We are leading reforms to strengthen public education and the professional development of educators, along with ensuring non-discrimination in the school system. Until now, arbitrarily segregated. We are gradually giving free education both for primary, secondary, and higher education, tertiary education. We have adopted a tax reform with a twofold objective: to finance this new way of thinking about education and to make our taxation more equitable. We have promoted a labor reform which will increase collective bargaining and strengthen trade unions, and also because we want to have a more modern, we have to modernize labor relationship. We have also approved a new electoral system to improve competition and representative democracy, leaving behind the unequitable rules inherited from the dictatorship. Along with that, we have introduced substantive changes in the functioning of political parties and funding mechanisms as a way to tackle our transparency and poverty deficits. Primarily, this has meant more strict rules and the prohibition of funding from large companies, thus reducing the influence of money in politics. As a general framework of this process, we have launched a debate to develop a constitution based on democracy that will be legitimate and updated through the broadest citizen participation possible. These are the most important transformations, but not the only ones. We can envision a positive balance, not only in terms of provision of these better public goods to our citizens, but also in conceptual terms. Today's social rights are part of our national lexicon, something unthinkable only a decade ago. The political process of this reform, as you can imagine, has not been easy, but what transformative process is. But what encourages us has much to do with the Swedish experience. What we seek is to face the same problem, to protect our citizens from social hazards, generate a sense of community, and build collaborative solutions to public problems. Certainly, we start from different points in history. What you look for is to improve a system in place for decades. In turn, we seek to address comprehensively the construction of institutional framework that achieves. The European welfare state today faces enormous challenges. You know them better than I do, especially with regard to improving the incentives and financing. Social Europe has also faces great challenges with the changes in the social, political, and cultural foundation of the countries. Demographic transformation, the need to reformulate the alliance between the middle class and workers, migrations, and cultural changes associated with modernization. On our side, and as I said, the tasks are different because our level of development and our needs are also different. When democracy returned, 40% of Chileans were under the poverty line. Today, figures tell us that now there are fewer than 10% of the population. But we face a new problem, the emergence of a middle class that is highly vulnerable to social and economic contingencies. Facing this scenario has required new solutions, because a scheme based on targeted social policies that were effective in reducing poverty is now exhausted. We are convinced that it is necessary to move towards universal policies based on social rights. That is what is behind the educational reform we drive today. And it is the horizon that inspired the pension reform we implemented in my first government, when for the first time, thousands and hundreds of thousands of adults received a pension. And some of the others improved their pensions that were very, very low. It is also what the government of President Lagos did with the OCHA plan in health, which aims to ensure coverage and attention of a set of prevalent diseases, a list that has grown. In short, the changes put in place aim to lay the foundation for what has begun to be called a social state of rights, which will progressively strengthen the pillars of education, health, and pensions. We do it indeed mindful of our reality as a middle-income country, which also has the challenge of making a productive transformation that will allow us to go beyond commodity export, adding value through innovation, to cope with the fluctuations of economic cycles with greater resilience. That's why the Swedish experience is so valuable to us, because what we seek has been largely achieved here. We were able to build a cohesive society within a framework of democratic freedoms alongside strong social majorities. It is a lesson we have learned, and we hope to continue learning. In conclusion, as Chileans, what we aspire is to live in a democracy with profound social content that allows us to build a governance based on legitimacy and social cohesion. Nothing more and nothing less. Friends, the recent history of Chile has been marked by momentous events, from the breakdown of democracy to its recovery. We should continue working for this democracy to become stronger, with a social foundation that consolidates and projects it in the long term. It has not been easy, because giving up privilege is not easy and becoming a cohesive country is a challenging process. But we continue our path, as when we were able to restart a democratic march, and as it has been every time we have proposed making the transformation that our society needs. And along with these needs, we need economic growth, greater productivity, and sustainable development. This is the route which we are following. Without an easiness or voluntarism, which can end up being an obstacle to sustainable transformation. Because, as your great poet, Charles Stuermer said, without knowing it, the biggest fan is the biggest skeptic. Chile and Sweden will continue striving for our dreams with our feet firmly on the ground, because our people deserve it. Thank you so much.